Good afternoon and welcome to the Department of State. We are very gratified that we received confirmation a few minutes ago that Sarah Sheward has departed Tehran en route to Muscat, Oman. You've seen the statements by the President and Secretary celebrating her release, but also recognizing that the cases of Shane Bauer and Josh Fatal remain unresolved. We are grateful for the efforts of Swiss, Omani, and other diplomats who have worked diligently over many months to help us reach this point. The release of Sarah Sheward demonstrates that Iranian authorities have the ability to resolve these cases if they choose. Iranian authorities made the decision to release Sarah Sheward. We hope that they will make the same decision regarding Josh Fatal and Shane Bauer as soon as possible. Secretary Clinton is preparing to depart Sharm el-Sheikh this morning. She joined President Mubarak in early meetings with Prime Minister Netanyahu and President Abbas. She then met with the parties separately before convening a trilateral meeting along with Special Envoy George Mitchell. And following a lunch hosted by President Mubarak, Secretary Clinton resumed her trilateral meeting with the parties. And then before preparing for departure to Jerusalem, met with UAE Foreign Minister Abdullah bin Zayed. We released a few minutes ago also just a fact sheet that underscores some of the details of Scott Gratian's travel last week to Juba and Khartoum laying out a path not only in terms of what we expect both parties north and south to do in preparation for the referendum in early 2011, but also laid out the potential benefits and consequences, benefits if the referendum is successfully administered and consequences if the actions by one or both sides fall short. We'll actually hope to get Scott Gratian here tomorrow at the start of the daily press briefing to kind of outline in greater detail, his conversations of last week. I just want to highlight a couple of upcoming, one speech today that call your attention to the fact that Assistant Secretary Arturo Valenzuela spoke this morning at the annual Americas Conference in Miami, or in Coral Gables to be more specific, on the Americas, a new era of transition and innovation. And tomorrow at Johns Hopkins, Assistant Secretary Esther Brimmer will speak about the United States at the UN and beyond, a world of transnational challenges. Her speech tomorrow will set the stage for the upcoming opening of the UN General Assembly, and we also expect to have Esther here at the end of the week to give you a kind of a UN preview. Matt?
Yeah. On Iran, what's your understanding of the conditions of her release? In other words, was there any amount of bail paid?
The United States did not pay anything for her release. As you know, the government of Iran, through their judicial process, had specific requirements for her release, and arrangements were made that satisfied those requirements.
In other words, someone paid something.
Someone provided sufficient assurances to the government of Iran that satisfied their stipulations for release.
Well, sufficient assurances in terms of cash?
I can't tell you. I don't know, what the specific actions were. As you know, we had our Swiss protecting power working on the ground in Tehran. We had Omani diplomats working on our behalf. Other countries have weighed in with Iran both over months and in recent days. The combination of that diplomatic effort, was that the arrangements were made that satisfied Iranian requirements under their judicial system.
But presumably, you've been in touch with the Swiss and the Omanis and the others, correct? I just find it a little hard to believe that you don't know what arrangements were made.
To be honest with you, we haven't, you know, since, you know, the party is now airborne, we haven't received a full debrief of what has transpired the last 24 hours.
Just in terms of the terms of her release again, can you say anything about whether she's expected to return to Iran for a trial, if she would need to do so for a trial, if there were one for the other two that are still in detention?
Well, again, that's a matter for Iranian authorities.
What's your understanding of the terms of her release in that regard?
Well, again, that's a matter for Iranian authorities. As you know, we understand their public statements, you know, this is an ongoing legal proceeding.
Which means what? I mean, what does that mean?
Again, that you know, I mean, our view, you know, then, when, you know, a year ago and now, is that, you know, these three individuals are not guilty of any crime. We understand that Iran needed some time to satisfy itself that they pose no threat to Iran. We do not believe they pose any threat to Iran. We do not believe that they've broken any laws other than crossing an unmarked border. You know, we're happy that this has been, you know, that you know, the case of Sara Sheward has been resolved. We would hope that the cases of Shane Bauer and Josh Fatale can be resolved. But, you know, to the extent that there may be an ongoing, you know, judicial proceeding or an ongoing investigation, I would defer to Iranian authorities.
Iranian government saying that they release her purely because of medical condition, not because of anything else. Do you believe that? And do you think that might affect the release of the other two, that they don't have any reason to release them?
Well, I mean, as the president said in his statement, Iran has shown compassion in the case of Sara Sheward. We would hope that Iran would demonstrate the same compassion with respect to the other hikers. I mean, the facts behind their case are identical. You know, these were three hikers, three innocent young American citizens. They crossed the border. Iran has had more than enough time to investigate and understand that you know, that there are no hidden facts in this case. So we would hope that Iran, having, you know, taken the decision to release Sara Sheward, now demonstrates that within the Iranian legal process, you have the ability to reach the same result for the other two hikers.
These ducks.
No, all right. There were reports about 5 hours ago that she was already getting ready to leave and she was doing the paperwork to leave the prison. It's kind of hard to understand how it is that the United States doesn't know the terms of her release when it's been out there for 5 hours now. I mean, I understand the U.S. wasn't the one who was in the negotiations. It wasn't the one in there with her, but how is that possible that Oman or the Swiss haven't relayed the terms of that release to you yet at this point? I guess I'm just asking, how is that possible that you don't know anything about whether any bail was paid?
I mean, you're asking if money has changed hands, and the short answer is we don't know.
Has the United States State Department hasn't been asking the Swiss protective powers whether any money was paid?
Well, I mean, all I can say is, you know, for example, as I said a moment ago, you know, if the question is, was, you know, did the United States government pay anything for this release, the answer is no. As to what arrangements were made that satisfied, you know, requirements under the Iranian judicial process, we were not a part of that. We don't know.
And then what was it, a private plane that flew her out of Tehran?
It was an Omani plane.
An Omani private plane or an
Omani? I just don't happen to know the answer to that question. She's accompanied by Omani diplomats and I believe Swiss diplomats, so I suspect it was an Omani government plane.
And will U.S. officials in Oman greet her at the airport, presumably?
The answer is undoubtedly yes.
PJ, can you talk a little bit about what the Omani role was here? They seem to have taken the lead from the Swiss at some point recently.
I don't think it's a matter of of leadership, you know, Matt per se. I mean, first of all, the Swiss have a particular, you know, role as our protecting power. They represent formally our diplomatic interests in Iran, since we do not have diplomatic relations with the Iranian government. Oman is one of a number of countries that we have, you know, solicited over many months. They do have a relationship, you know, with Iran, and you know, particularly in you know, recent days and weeks, became a key interlocutor to help us, you know, work this case, you know, with the Iranian government. And we're very grateful to the role that that Oman has played. They're not the only one. There were a number of countries. Their secretary, you know, raised this on a regular basis with countries that we knew had diplomatic relations and the ability to converse, you know, with Iran. And we're very grateful that this one case has been resolved, and we hope the other two can be resolved under, you know, similar circumstances.
Okay. When you say it became a key interlocutor in the recent days and weeks, can you just explain what that means? I mean, were they shuttling back and forth between the Swiss and the Iranians, or what exactly were they doing?
Again, yeah, hard for me to characterize since we are not there. But
they weren't doing it in a vacuum. I mean, no. You knew what that they you asked them to do it, and
yes.
Presumably then they would report back to you and tell things are looking good or not so good.
You know, Swiss diplomats have been steadily engaged on these cases, and Omani diplomats have as well. So, you know, Oman, its diplomatic corps in Tehran, was actively and repeatedly engaged with the Iranian government to help us resolve this case.
And the Omanis are engaged in the cases of the two remaining hikers as well?
They have been conversing with the government of Iran on multiple occasions, you know, seeking, as we do, the release of all three hikers.
Turkey is one of them?
Yeah, we have had conversations with Turkish officials, and they in turn have they carried our message to Tehran, yes.
One more, this is just kind of a vocabulary issue. You used the word several times, resolved, that we're happy that Sarah Short's case is resolved. But in fact, if she was released on bail, there's still a, is it your understanding, there's still an ongoing legal?
I think I also said that, yeah, that there is an ongoing investigation, you know, we would hope that a similar result, you know, can emerge for Josh Fatale and Shane Bauer. Sure.
PJ.
Sarah?
Yep.
Sorry, when is she coming back to U.S. soil?
I do not know what, I know that she's currently airborne en route to Muscat, Oman. You know, we obviously look forward to having her reunited with her family. And when she comes back to the United States, you know, those are arrangements to be made, you know, and details that will be discussed through her family.
Envoy Mitchell told reporters today that we are making progress. How substantive is this progress? How is it different, let's say, from 2 weeks ago? And what was discussed as first item on the agenda? Was it the settlement or the Jewishness of the state?
I had the opportunity to, converse with the team this morning. I think we would characterize the discussions today as serious and direct discussions on the core issues. Those discussions will continue tomorrow. As the Secretary said, en route to Sharm el-Sheikh, it'd be very important for, the leaders of, on both sides. You know, they have a special responsibility. These direct negotiations are the only mechanism through which Palestine achieves a viable state and Israel achieves the security that it deserves. They have a vested interest in seeing this process, continue. They will have to find ways to overcome the immediate obstacles so that the direct negotiations can continue and ultimately, solutions found that resolves all of the outstanding issues as part of the process.
Peter, just to follow up, Mr. Netanyahu, a day or so ago, actually tied the Palestinian recognizing Israel as a Jewish homeland or as a Jewish state with the stopping of the settlement activity and so on. Considering that this is an issue that came in the aftermath of the 2001 election of Ariel Sharon, do you agree with the premise that this ought to be a trade-off? And does the United States have a position on this, that the Palestinians must recognize Israel as a Jewish state in order for the settlements to stop?
Well, ultimately, this is an agreement that the leaders of Israel and the leaders of the Palestinian Authority must achieve. It will be their agreement. We will play a role as a key facilitator. As George Mitchell reiterated again today, we are prepared to offer our ideas as needed as the process goes forward. On the one hand, this is an issue of substance. We know the core issues, and solutions have to be found that resolve the core issues at the heart of the effort. By the same token, this is a political challenge. As George Mitchell said after the first round of talks here in Washington, both sides will have to move off of public stated positions and reach compromises on firmly held and emotional issues. To the extent that it poses a political challenge for both leaders, they have to continue to seek creative ways of resolving and satisfying the requirements of each one. Part of this process, as Prime Minister Netanyahu and President Abbas, build trust through the process, is it'll be vitally important that each understands what the other leader needs. This cannot be a situation where one side wins and the other side loses. You have to find solutions where both sides get what they need to reach an agreement, recognizing that neither side will get everything that it wants.
PJ, thank you. Al Jazeera TV. Just if I may just go back to Sarah Short for a second. I know you've touched on this, but might the bail have been paid by the Swiss in such a way that the United States adds it to the bill at the end of the year? Is that something that might have happened? And can you speak to whether or not this payment of bail infringes the sanctions in place against Iran or not in any way?
Not knowing the specifics of the particular arrangement, I can't say what the final conditions were. All I can tell you is that the United States did not pay anything for the release. We're not aware of any information that would trigger sanctions in any way.
Is it correct to assume that your main focus now, or your definition of the success of this round of talks, is to keep the Palestinians in as opposed to walk out after the 26th, should Netanyahu decide not to extend the moratorium?
Well, I think as we characterize the discussions today, they were serious discussions on all core issues. But as the Secretary also suggested in her in her interactions with the traveling press en route to Sharm el-Sheikh, the solution both in the short term and the long term involves potential actions by both sides. This is not just an issue of one issue. Everything in the process is interrelated, and it will be the perception by the leaders that they are getting what they think they need, both to overcome the immediate issues over the next couple of weeks, but then that creates momentum and trust and confidence that the process can in fact yield results and yield progress towards an ultimate agreement. But we are working with the parties to understand how we overcome both the short-term challenge and in the process we create momentum and trust and confidence that we think can get them into the serious serious, you know, discussions and negotiations that helps us resolve all of the core issues within the next year.
Quick follow-up on this. PJ, is moving the direct talks from Sharm el-Sheikh to Jerusalem to Ramallah, would that make them sporadic and spotty rather than concentrated?
No, it is characteristic of the of the way this process is going to unfold. I think, as George Mitchell mentioned today, beyond the meetings tomorrow, there will be follow-up meetings, you know, with the teams from on the Palestinian-Israeli side that will, in fact, then tee up additional leader meetings in the next couple of weeks. As we've said, we expect to see the leaders get together, you know, roughly every 2 weeks. So, you know, we're satisfied with the, you know, the seriousness with which the leaders are taking this. You know, as I say, this is their process, and ultimately it has to yield results that satisfy the policy and political requirements of both the Israelis and Palestinians. I think we're satisfied that they are doing what we would hope that they would do, and we would hope that they would find ways in which the process can continue and accelerate. Samir.
There is a report in the Middle East that Senator Mitchell will be visiting Syria and Lebanon. Do you have anything on this?
Senator Mitchell will stay in the region after Secretary Clinton returns home. He will visit both Syria and Lebanon.